This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for Behind the Headlines is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Welcome to a special edition of Behind the Headlines. I'm Eric Barnes, publisher of the Memphis Daily News. Thanks for joining us. Today, a special roundtable press conference with Mayor A.C. Wharton. Mayor Wharton, thanks for joining us.
Good morning. Thank you.
And a special guest on the panel is Lauren Lee from Fox 13 News. We'll start with you, Lauren, and your first question for the mayor.
Well, we wanted to talk about pensions. What we saw a couple weeks ago was that the pension compromise was reached. And the main thing that surprised me was this age limit, the 52 for police and fire, 62 for all other employees, only starting for new hires. And for months we've been hearing that won't solve the problem. Y'all wanted to have it with 10 years and newer. Why give in on that point? It seemed to be the major sticking point this whole time.
We actually did not give in. We simply found another way to make up for the monetary difference that we would have accrued had we stuck with our original retirement dates. Here's what I said. When the negotiators came back to me and they said, the union doesn't want to budge on that, I said, I don't care whether they budge or not. I want the money. They said, well, how can we get it? Well, you increase the amount that those employees, the ones who would have been excluded from our changes, and make sure that they have to pay more. They're going to have to pay up to 8%. New folks coming in will pay more. Those who are not yet vested will pay more. So when it comes to the dollars we want it to get, we end up in precisely the same place.
But some people criticize the city that the county was more aggressive, cut back more on benefits, long-term benefits, and that, you know, in the big picture, it's really a nationwide, cities, states, really the federal government, talking about these long-term benefits. And them being unsustainable. Is the benefit plan that was just settled on, is it sustainable for the city of Memphis?
Yes, but we made it clear that we're going to look at what we've done for 3 years, check the performance, see if we're on target for the goals we had, and everybody's agreed that if we're not on target, then we'll go back. There's a reopener in there. We don't know what the markets are going to do with respect to our investments. We don't know precisely how many people we will be hiring. Will we continue to shrink the number of employees? So that's why we placed a reopener in it. I will say this. It's the first step. The county didn't do it in 1 year. We started reform back when I was in the county. There's no city anywhere that has done this in one fell swoop. You can't expect that. But if we stay on target, then it will be sustainable. If we see, we'll start the study in 24 months. That gives us 6 months or so to do a study and make sure we're on target. It assumes a return of 8.5%. Traditionally, our return has been 11%. So we've got some room in there. So there's a good chance that we may not have to make any changes.
Speaking of staying on target, we all know there's a $40 million deficit that we're going to have to be dealt with. But some say that the bonuses that were given to employees that amounted to $750 a piece for full-time employees, $200 for part-time employees, passed by a vote of 75, but there was a lot of discussion about whether this was the best way. And there was also some discussion as to whether or not the motivation behind this. Some even accused this of being political expediency. What would be your response to that?
Well, had it been political expediency, we would have done this before the election. We have absolutely nothing to gain from this. The election is over now. We did not have to negotiate with the unions on this. We simply said, here's some previously unrecognized funds that we had not contemplated. We made a commitment. It was no secret that if we find funds that have not been previously allocated, then we will look at returning some of those to the employees to begin the restoration process of the 4.6%. So it was not politically motivated. It was simply keeping a promise that had been made. It was not a secret, promise. When it comes to the debt, let's be realistic on that. If we're going to adopt the principle that the employees will not get anything until we take care of this debt, they'll never get anything. That won't happen in our lifetime. Let's face it. These debts are accrued on a 30-year basis. You take out bonds 30 years. The shortfall next year is $15 million, then $20 million the next year. Take out that $5 million. Is it really going to solve the problem? And even with the $5 million that they're getting, the employees are still giving us $10 million toward getting our fiscal house in order. We had contemplated $16 million in savings as a result of the 4.6. So you pull off $5 or $6 million. It's still $10 million that we have taken from the employees. I think it's unfair to contemplate or expect to balance and get our fiscal house totally in order on the backs of the employees.
But at the end of the day, I mean, as you start looking, it seems like budget season just ended and we're starting to look, to the next budget. But
right.
It is, again, $40 million estimated gap right now. There are two ways to get there. You raise revenues or you cut expenses at the simplest level. What is your prediction now? Do you think, are we going to see a property tax increase to make up that $40 million? Or do you think there are other places, if it's not the employees who are going to see their expenses, reduced, where are those reduced expenses going to come from?
Well, we could always visit the idea of outside grants that we make. There are millions of dollars in outside grants that we give to outside agencies. There are service reductions, quite frankly. For example, just some very basic things. In other comparable cities, Nashville, Tennessee, if you put an old sofa out, you pay an extra fee for someone coming to pick that up. Old refrigerator. Guess what citizens pay in Memphis? Zero. You pay in other cities. So there are other places. There are other revenue sources, if you'll recall. The inspection fee. Those things, there are some revenue
sources. So fees other than the property tax.
Other than the property tax are there. But again, we're still going to look for areas where we can reduce expenses and cut. That's the first way we go.
Right. Jackson.
We're on the cusp of Christmas. I want to wish you a Merry Christmas, first of all. And at a recent Christmas party, I ran into Councilman Bill Boyd, who says that he remembers that you once promised to put the city on a zero-based budgeting basis, and hasn't happened yet. What's the outlook for that, and what are the impediments to it?
We're working on it this year. We're working on it this year. That will be the process we will follow. Of course, let's be realistic about zero-based budgeting. Do you want to put your police department on a zero-based budget? That assumes, when you use that, you assume that we could do without this particular service. Because under true zero-based budgeting, you assume that you're getting nothing, as opposed to, start where you are already. I think it would be a flat-out waste of time to say, let's just pretend we don't have a police department and spend 2 weeks going through that and letting the anarchists rule. So you cannot really do that when it comes to some things, but you can say your zero is your present budget and no more and work from there. But we are going to go to the ground floor, examine every service that we're providing, and we've already cut back on a lot of things. We used to escort everything that wanted to come through town. We'd put a police escort on it. The mounted patrol, those things are good and they look good, but quite frankly, we didn't get that much out of them. So we're going to look at everything. There are certain things the traditional police functions, you can't talk about. We're going to get rid of that. But anything other than those things that are uniquely given to public authorities, we're going to look at it.
Well, let's go to you, Lauren, and I think it's a segue to a question about both. We've talked a little bit about the unions, and we've talked about the police department. And let's follow up on a couple stories you've done on tickets at the police department.
Right. Actually, my first thought when I saw the bonus, I thought, I wonder if this is a way to get the police officers to start writing tickets again. Is there any point when something needs to be done. We're in the fourth or fifth month now at this point.
And this is the ticket writing slowdown.
Sure. I think
the far fewer tickets being written by the Memphis Police Department than historically were written.
I think the pace we're at right now, the last I heard, was 33,000 less than this time last year.
Let me, anytime you discuss law enforcement functions, you have to build a wall between revenue and how much money you're raising. It's just grossly unconstitutional to say we're going to enforce the law so we can get money. The way you approach it and the way we will approach it is to look at those areas, look at our traffic accidents and whatever, look at those that are caused by speeding. If we see that the accidents are still going up, but the tickets are going down, then obviously somebody's not enforcing because people are still speeding through a given intersection. Officers are there. Why aren't they detected? There will be ways. We will not look at how much money we're bringing in. That is unconstitutional. We're going to look at the safety function. You write tickets not to generate money. You write tickets and citations to improve safety.
But
and that's
what
we will do.
Do you think that the police department is actively and purposely slowing down the number of tickets it writes in protest to some of the cuts and cutbacks that you've put in place?
I have no evidence of that. I simply do not have the evidence. We have the raw numbers, but we do not know what the motivation is. And I'm not going to go out and say, aha, yeah, they're doing it. And then somebody will say, well, prove it, and I can't prove it. Bottom line is I can't prove it. But again, we'll go forward. We will look at the accident rates in areas where there were once a high number of citations issued and see what the deal is.
Okay.
Let's talk briefly about the what many feel is an albatross around the city's neck, and this is riverfront development. Started by your predecessor, at first I think it was $25 to $30 million was the estimate. $7, $8 million have already been spent. Now we find out that there's soil erosion problems or whatever. Should a cap be placed on this project and let's just get it done, get a portion of it done and move on here, or are we going to go the full haul?
I think a cap should be placed on it, but after you examine, and I will call for this at the beginning of the new term, anytime you have plans that are, 10 years old and are not complete, you need to go back and revisit those plans, the premises, and just see if they still hold valid. We will do that within the first 90 days of the new term.
But is the plan, clearly, there's a big master plan for the riverfront that's been there for 10 years, and very little of it's been executed. They're about to finish the landing for the river boats, and that'll be done. But is it more than just an addressing of plans, but is it addressing the leadership of Riverfront Development Corporation? I mean, the same people have been running it for those 10 years, and really not a lot's been done. What's been done has been done far over budget than expected.
Yeah, all of the above. The premise of turning it over to RDC was that because they would be outside government, they could be much more efficient, wouldn't get caught up in all of these bidding requirements, all of this civil service stuff, and that the city would get a better deal. So we need to examine that.
But that
is also.
An outside observer, it seems that that has not worked.
Well, in some respects, keep in mind, they maintain the whole riverfront. They have probably maintained, in terms of keeping it clean and weeds cut and all of that and stopping erosion, they've probably done that much more efficiently than the city could have. But the overall development aspect of it, we need to go back and carefully examine that.
Jackson.
Here's a little bit of a retrospective question. Early this year, you were pretty put out, and a lot of people in city government were put out, at the way state government was handling the city-county school merger situation. Mm-hmm. Now that we're a year later, and some other things have happened, including that little standoff you had with the city school board, when it still existed as such. How is everything progressing on that front? Does it look like things will work out?
I think they will. I think they've got great leadership, good folks on both the transition committee and the school boards. Jackson, if you'll recall, the school board ended up precisely at the compromise that I had offered, basically pulling them together and add a few to that. So I'm glad to see that that's what the judge ultimately signed off on. I think it's working real well, quite frankly, keeping in mind the volatility of racial politics that we often play here in Memphis and Shelby County. I think it's working well.
Do you think that the right now most of the suburban areas, Germantown, Collierville, Bartlett, they're looking at whether they can break off, they can afford to break off, whether it makes sense to them to break off and form their own special school districts. Do you have any sense of whether they'll do that?
No, I do not. I will say this, having been county mayor and looking at what school systems cost, from a fiscal, from a bottom line,
Well, part of that, and you mentioned being county mayor, part of that expense that is, you know, increasingly coming up in the conversations about whether those municipalities can break off with their own school district is the buildings.
Right.
You know, if those buildings can be handed to a new school district free and clear, it's a much more fiscally attainable goal to set up a new school district. What's your thinking on that? That, and you see a lot of people starting to talk about that. Can those schools, those suburban schools, be handed over to new school districts?
I've read cases on both sides of it. Some judge is going to have to decide that. My reading and interpretation of the law is that they cannot. And keep in mind, if they go down that road, keep in mind that the citizens of Memphis also pay, although the county issued the money
right.
to build the buildings, because I was over there. But I collected, as county mayor, I collected a good part of the money from residents within the city limits of Memphis.
Right.
So the folks, the citizens of the city of Memphis also pay for those schools. And I don't know what happens, but we're not going to stand idly by and just let our investment be taken away from us.
Lauren.
On the school issue, what were your thoughts on the new school board denying 17 charter schools? We're looking at reform. This seems to be what the governor's plan is for reform, especially in Memphis. The bottom 5% of schools, 80% of them in the state, are in Memphis. Were you disappointed at all to see this?
Well, I don't, you know, I don't use words like disappointed. I do question that standard, which I think is overly broad, that if the granting of the charter school permit would have a financial effect negatively on city schools, then don't grant it. I think that's too broad. I don't think that denial will stand up. If it does, I'm sure it will be challenged in court. Now, on the other side of the coin, it's like flying a plane. You got to have two pilots on there in the same cabin, depends whether there are 18 people or 180 on there. So the infrastructure of the city school system is the same. So I can see what they're saying when they say you're taking money away from us. But I think quality rules the day. People make the choices.
Let's move on to, in the last year and a half, schools obviously merger dominated the headlines. But another thing that has been in the news quite a bit, a number of big ticket projects, everything from Bass Pro to Mitsubishi to Electrolux, to Pinnacle Airlines moving downtown, the Riverboat Steam Company coming to Memphis. All those projects, in one way or another, have involved a great deal of incentives from the city of Memphis. Do you look back at any of those projects and think some of them were too lucrative, that we gave away too much in terms of incentives, in terms of revenue, in terms of tax breaks?
You can always Monday morning quarterback. I don't think so, not at this point. I cannot look at any of them and say that. Again, you can always second guess if you look at what other jurisdictions are doing. And let's face it, we're in a competitive world. And if you look at what other cities, states are doing, I think we're in line with what's being
even with Electrolux, and that's the one that probably gets the most criticism. That, you know, at the state level, the legislature criticized the former governor for giving away too much. Just across the board, there's been a lot of criticism. The Electrolux deal was too much of a giveaway to a company.
Well, we can take the entire show on that. Let me look at it this from a local standpoint. Keep in mind, the money that we're spending in Shelby County does not go to Electrolux. That is our land down there. They can't take that with them, even if they were to leave up 15, 20 years or whatever. We are making an investment into port facilities and whatever that we will be able to use, even if they were to. So we're improving our own property.
And one more question on that front, which is, do you see more projects? I mean, is there another Electrolux in the wings? Are there more projects that could fall in Memphis in the next year?
There are major projects. Now, whether they'll fall in the next year, I do not know. Let me make one other point just
sure.
quickly. The way Chattanooga got Volkswagen is they put up part of their local money. The way Clarksville got the semiconductor facility up, if they put up part of their local money, we had been out of that. We, in Shelby County, Memphis, we paid for Volkswagen. We paid for semiconductor.
Through the state.
Through the state. Right. We sent. We were the only county, big county, that was sending tons of money up there, watching Chattanooga grow, watching Clarksville grow, and we're sitting here twiddling our thumbs. So when I called the governor and said, look, we got to do it, he said, what do you want? I said, treat us no less favorably, or no more favorably than you've done Chattanooga and the other places, and
but
that's what we did.
And I'm sorry to dominate the questions here, but isn't that partly, it's a de facto criticism of Mayor Harrington, that Mayor Harrington wasn't contacting the state, he wasn't in the game. Those other communities you mentioned were in the game. What has the reception been at the state level to you asking for help, saying we're open for business, saying we want to play the same games that, you know, be a part of the same deals that Chattanooga and other parts of the state are getting? Have they welcomed that, or are they shocked by that?
No, no. Each time we've gone to them, they've been receptive. City Brewing, you didn't mention it. I thought we needed state help on that. They were standing in the ready with some of the weight limit problems. KTG, that project started back when I was county mayor. The first place they went was to Nashville. I sent them there first so we could get a package there. So the state has been receptive.
Actually, I want to follow up on that whole economic thing, especially with the situation that's developed at Morgan Keegan. There's been talk of city help, bailout in some form or fashion. Do you see it coming to that?
We're not at that stage. I do know that it would be in the best interest of Memphis and Shelby County and the state of Tennessee if, in order to keep Morgan Keegan here, we could come up with a reasonable package of incentives. But again, at this point in time, there's no way in the world I could say what that might be. This is not like someone saying, we're going to leave if you don't give us a railroad spur. This is a financial world. I've never played on that court. So I do believe, I'm convinced it would be in the best interest of this city if we were to keep them here.
Jackson.
Well, in the recent election, you got involved a little bit. You won one, Lee Harris. You lost one, Janice Fuller Love. How is this next council going to work with you better, about the same? Just exactly what will be the difference?
It's meeting per meeting. Any mayor who goes in saying, boy, I got X number of votes, it simply requires eternal vigilance and working. So I'll always remain open, but as far as saying, oh, it's going to be worse or it's going to be better, I've never done that. I've found that council members take each issue on a case-by-case basis, and that's what we do. I don't count any permanent enemies down there, nor do I find any permanent alliances or allies down there.
Or thorns in your side.
I don't have much of a side, so they can stick me much.
Lauren.
A revenue issue, but also an issue for downtowners, people who live, work downtown, people who go to Tiger games, Grizzly games. So word on the street is no more free street parking. Are you working with parking meter companies right now to blanket the downtown area?
Yes, we are.
Merry Christmas.
It's amazing. We've got it backwards right now. Right when the crowds are there, guess what? No, the meter's cut off at 6 o'clock. So we're going to bring it at least into the 20th century. You'll be able to use your credit card. How many people walk around with a pocket full of quarters now? You pull up there and you're rich and you don't have a quarter, so you walk off.
You think these will be done in the next couple months or 6 months?
Next six months. We're working on it right now.
And what kind of revenue could this bring in? Any estimates on that?
I've forgotten what it is, right. But it will, again, right. Now, keep in mind, you don't install parking meters to bring in revenue. It's a traffic control device. It keeps folks from hogging up the meters, but it will, I put it this way, it will pay for the cost of the operation and improving
several
the
million,
meter.
Though, right?
Yeah.
Several million dollars okay. a
again,
year is projected?
Yes, but again, we don't do it for revenue. I mean, I have to say that. Matter of fact, you could run that across the end of
the question
screen.
That's made you most uncomfortable, is the parking meter question.
Wait till Tiger games. People park all the way down to the Civil Rights Museum for free right now, and that's going away, right?
I will say this, though. in the event there is increased revenue, that means more that means more police patrols, better lighting, all sorts of improved amenities downtown, just in case there is a byproduct that we get.
Very tactful. Last question. Sure. There'd been a priority of yours and a lot of accomplishments in terms of greening Memphis. You know, the Green Line is a big one, Shelby Farms, the bike lanes that have gone in. What, looking ahead at next year, are there more bike lanes going in, more Green Line type paths? What sort of activity will be
again,
on that?
Again, all of the above. We will have what we call a clean green major initiative with a major partner leading that initiative. Folks, not merely on the physical amenities of bike lanes and whatever, but jobs. I mean, solar, all of those things, improving our MLGW grid so that when residents install solar panels and they have excess, they can sell it back. We can't do that now. Sell it back to MLGW. All of the above. More clean and green jobs, more amenities. I want to get the bike lanes over the old Harahan Bridge going into Arkansas, connect the Greenway with the Green Line, and all of that's in the works. They're getting great approval from the citizens.
And last question, the pyramid is Bass Pro. When will we see a big fish on the pyramid?
I don't know when we'll see the big fish, but we're in the process of gutting it out. And for those who look at minority hiring, we've got 47% minorities hired on the first phase of that. I don't know exactly when the big fish will hit the side of the building. But
all right. Well, and we leave it there. Thank you for joining us, Mayor Wharton. Thank you. Merry Christmas. Happy holidays. We'll see you next year. Thank you. Catch you off. Sorry about that.